time. His ministry was begun in 1848 by a Swedish student of his father, who settled in a new school in South Island. In time, the decision was made to partner with the Lockridge community and New Sweden congregations to become the first Lutheran congregation in Lockridge Township, thus preserving the historical continuity of the New Sweden congregation. This faith journey of 150 years has been an impressive one. That has existed only because of God's blessing and divine guidance. We are no longer just Swedish. Today we represent changing times with diversity and ethnicity. You know, Catholic, Bishop, Baptist, Methodist, etc. All comes together is not the top, just the ELCA's trying to attempt to and maybe will succeed in the ecumenism of the church at large. We are all embracing the teachings of Buckman, especially knowing that we are saved by the grace of God. I would like to make an announcement that we will be having a communion this morning, Bishop Elvin and Pastor. Bishop will be doing the communion and we will have a very hospitable and find your place, and as soon as we are all seated, we will have a blessing, and then we will
sins and the words of forgiveness. Found on page 77. Let's see. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us. Renew us and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. For those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God, and bestows on them the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Oh.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
This man
shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord. The Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness.
Gospel according to St. Luke, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said, do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. The Gospel of the Lord. Grace to you and peace from God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for that music. This group can really sing. That shouldn't surprise me because this group is overrepresented in terms of talent and leadership. This group is blessed. What you may lack or feel you may lack sometimes in numbers is way overcompensated for by the quality of the people who come from this place. And part of what I'm here this morning for is to thank you for your service to the larger church. Yes, I want to say congratulations to this congregation for its 150 years of history traced back through this congregation in Lockridge and the New Sweden congregation. Congratulations, yes, but also to say thanks to you for your service to the larger church and say thanks with you to God who has given us the grace to be God's people through this particular history. I say congratulations to you on behalf of the other congregations of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, our denomination, about 11,000 congregations throughout the United States and the Caribbean. I say congratulations to you on behalf of the other 150 congregations of our Southeastern Iowa Synod. With the founding of the congregation in New Sweden, really began a history that has evolved into the Lutheran presence in this part of the state of Iowa. And I want to thank those of you of the congregation here at First Augustana in Lockridge for providing this opportunity this weekend for the celebration of this history. And I'm very grateful for the presence of people like Pastor Nelson, Pastor Engstrom, Pastor Fisher, because I think that they help us remember some of the history that has gone on in these places, at least in recent years. I want to say a special word of thanks to Pastor Fisher. For the last several years, he has served your congregation. This will be his last Sunday in a leadership role here, and he is really concluding his service here. And on behalf of our Synod, I want to say thank you to you, Roger, for your generous giving of yourself, and I know I speak for the members of this congregation, that they are grateful for your sharing. It's another transition in the life of the history of this congregation, and we in the Synod office look forward to working with you as we work out another arrangement for pastoral leadership for this place. Interestingly to me, I recognize many of you sitting there this morning. That represents for me a sign, at least for me as one individual who's not from here, but a sign of how overrepresented this place is in the leadership of the church. When I think about the committees and organizations of our synod, the ways in which members of this relatively small congregation are represented on our hunger committee, on our board of outreach, on our rural ministry committee, on the synod council, as delegates to churchwide assemblies, and that is all represented by people sitting in this room at this moment in their current service to the larger church, members of this congregation. There obviously has been an understanding here in this place of what it means to be the church. 150 years ago, in 1848, did those immigrant Swedish Lutheran people recognize what fertile ground this would be for the growing of disciples? Do you realize what year it will be 150 years from now? It will be the year 2148. That's how far away we are from 1848 to 1998. Same distance from 1998 to 2148. What will the church, the people of God, be like in 2148? Will First Augustana Lutheran Church in Lockridge be here? You don't know the answer to that question. And neither do I. If First Augustana Lutheran Church in Lockridge is here in the year 2148, what will it look like? And what will those people be like? How much will they be like those of us who are here this morning? How much are we like those folks who gathered in 1848 and said, we need the church? Will the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America be here in 2148? And if it is, what will it look like? What kinds of folks will be a part of the church in the year 2148, if there's such a thing as a Lutheran church then? You don't know what that will look like, and neither do I. We don't know what the organization of the church will be like or what the church will be called 150 years from now. How does a church survive for 150 years? How does a congregation survive for 150 years? By faith. Those immigrants who planted this congregation in 1848 lived by faith. Those faithful people who have sustained this community over the past 150 years have lived by faith. And we remember those saints today. All of those who have lived and died and gone before us to a more permanent home. Those who have been a part of these communities of faith in New Sweden and Lockridge, we remember this morning when we celebrate 150 years of history. There are people who lived their lives of faith in this place so that this place of faith would be here today. There are people who gave of themselves so generously so that we might know the faith today. First lesson appointed for this morning says, and Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to Abram as righteousness. The faith. Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord said, that's what it takes to be righteous, to be right with me, the Lord. It takes belief. It takes faith. And that is what it takes to be the people of God. That's what it takes for a congregation to live for 150 years. And we don't know whether First Augustana and Lockridge will be here 150 years from now, and we don't know whether the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America will be here 150 years from now. But by faith, we believe that 150 years from now and 250 years from now and for all of eternity, the Church of Jesus Christ, which is the people of God, will be sustained by faith. It is faith that enables us to be the people of God. If we are to follow Jesus and Abraham and the saints who planted and sustained this congregation, we too must live by faith. We may wonder what the future holds. We cannot know the answer to that question. Abraham didn't know what the future held either.
He didn't know the answers to the questions. We read about that both in our first and second lessons for today. Look at the model this is of living by faith that is so appropriate for the marking of 150 years of history. A very significant passage in the history of American Lutheranism being marked here and this morning, here this morning in this place. But think how the journey of Abraham began. The letter of the Hebrews says, Abraham heard the call of God and went out, started out on his journey, not knowing where he was going. Now, starting out on a journey, not knowing where we are going, doesn't sound very smart. But that's lifted up as a model of faith. The reason it doesn't sound very smart to us is because we like to be in control. We like to know what the future holds. We want to know what's going to happen in the year 2148. Or short of that, we'd like to know what's going to happen tomorrow. Because we'd like to be in control. But to live by faith means to recognize that you and I are not in control, but that God is in control. And that's a whole lot better than you and me being in control. That's what it means to live by faith. It's to recognize we don't know what tomorrow will bring, any more than those settlers 150 years ago knew what tomorrow would bring. But that didn't stop them from living by faith. Abraham didn't know where the journey would take him. But by faith, he set out on that journey, putting himself in the hands of God and letting himself be led by God to the promised land. Not because he knew exactly where the promised land was going to be, not because he knew exactly what it was going to look like when he got there, but because he had faith, because he trusted that if God were doing the leading, the promises would be fulfilled. Now, that wasn't always so self-evident to Abram, and our first lesson for today makes that clear to us. Starts out with this great promise of God where the Lord says to Abram, those great words of Scripture that are repeated so often, the Lord says to Abram, do not be afraid, your reward shall be very great. Now this is after Abram had first received the promises. The promises were going to be that he would have a promised land and that he would have many descendants. And Abram says, hey, wait a minute. I'm not there yet. I haven't even gotten to the promised land. And besides that, Lord, I'm getting old, and my wife Sarah is getting old. We don't even have any children. I don't have any descendants. Abram really is doubting at this point. He's really wondering if there will be a future for the promises of God. He thought he heard the Lord, and he thought he understood those promises. But the exterior evidence didn't seem to add up to what Abraham expected. And he protests to God. He says, I don't know, God. I haven't seen it yet. Are there days like that for you and for me? Yes, God, I know I'm supposed to be faithful, but why do the good seem to suffer? Why do the evil seem to prosper? We ask those questions, but those are biblical questions. People have always asked those questions. And the Lord comes back and says, Abram, look. Then he gives this is all in a vision, it says, but he gives one of those great divine audiovisual demonstrations. He says, Abram, come outside with me and look up in the sky. Count the stars. Do that tonight, if it doesn't cloud up again. Do that tonight. Go out and count the stars, if you can, Abram. Your descendants will be as many as the stars in the heaven. And somehow, with that demonstration, Abram believed. And the Lord reckoned it to Abram as righteousness. We need to look to the Lord's evidence and not be discouraged by the exterior circumstances, which seem so often to discourage us. Though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. And as we live by faith, we can go into the next 150 years. The Lord said to Abram and Sarah, "Do not be afraid." Jesus says to his disciples, the opening words of our gospel lesson for today, "Do not be afraid, little flock." We sometimes feel like a little flock, whether we're in a big congregation or a little congregation. When we get out there in the world trying to be a faithful Christian, we sometimes feel small and little and weak and ineffective. And sometimes we wonder if the church isn't going downhill, and sometimes we wonder if the faith will survive. And Jesus would come to us and say, "Do not fear, little flock, for it is God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." And that would be the word for us today as well. God's word for Abram and Sarah is, "Don't be afraid. My promises are valid. They will be kept." Jesus' words to his disciples are, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." We are promised the kingdom. It is only with the receiving of the promises of God for the kingdom of God that a little group of Swedish immigrants could plant a church 150 years ago in New Sweden. It is only with the promises of God and with believing in the promises of God that we can continue to hold the faith in spite of all of the things in our world that might discourage us. It is only with the believing of the promises of God, it is only by living by faith that we can go into the future. What will the year 2148 look like? Will it be more or less different from 1998 than 1998 is from 1848? We live by faith. Not faith even in the history of a congregation, as glorious as that is. Not faith in the survival of a denominational label, as much as we love the name Lutheran. Not faith in the existence of particular buildings or particular places or particular organizations. But we live by faith that the promises of God are true. That in Jesus Christ our sin is forgiven. And in Jesus Christ we are given eternal life. When Hebrews 11, our second lesson for today, talks about Abram, it says, "By faith Abram went to a place and he didn't know where he was going. By faith Abraham wandered living in tents because he knew he had no permanent home there." And it says in Hebrews that that's because these people knew that their home wasn't here. Not in this history, not in this place, not in this time, but their permanent home was with God for eternity. God sent us Jesus Christ so that we might have faith in Jesus Christ, so that we might know that our sin is forgiven and that we might live by that faith that we are forgiven, that we might live by that faith that God will save us from all that might discourage us, all that would destroy us, and will give us eternal life. Jesus Christ died on the cross so that we would know God's forgiveness. We have faith that our sin is forgiven. Jesus Christ was raised from the dead so that we would know that the power of God's love is greater than all the powers of evil, including the powers of death. The power of God's love raises us up to be with God eternally. That's the faith by which we are called to live. Abram was told by the Lord, "Do not be afraid." Abram believed, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Jesus said, "Do not be afraid, little flock." And the disciples believed, and it was reckoned to them as righteousness. The Lord says to you and me this morning, do not be afraid. Live by faith. And as we live by faith, we are reckoned as the righteous people of God, sustained by the promises of God, which do not fail. Let us live by faith. Amen.
He descended to hell.
giver of every good. God, our shepherd, lead your church in paths of service to those that are poor and hungry. Give us hearts filled with trust that you will guide us in the days ahead as we minister among those in need. Gracious God,
hear our prayers.
Look with mercy on our children. Guard them with your strong arm. Protect them from all harm and come close to them when they are threatened or confused. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Inspire the leaders of nations with your gift of wisdom. Raise up women and men who will promote peaceful diplomacy and strategies that reflect your justice. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Keep us alert to the presence of Christ in the stranger, the hungry, the seeker, the co-worker, the spouse, the child, the person standing next to us. Give us grace to discern your loving presence in the diversity of all the human family. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
You are the divine physician who knows our every need. Come to our sick brothers and sisters, especially those whom we name in our hearts before you. Restore and revive them according to your mercy. Be with them in their need. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Look with love on those near death, and welcome them with all your saints into the strong and tender embrace of your eternal arms. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we call out to you in the power of the Spirit, confident that you hear the prayers we make in the name of Jesus, who is Lord, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
For the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
and then this table, and we'll stagger like this. And this group can go after the head table. But you understand the directions? I'll repeat them. The head table and these two tables will go first. Then that table where Bob is sitting, and then this table. And then back and forth. I hope you enjoy the meal.
So I think we all hand a round of applause for this celebration. I know that many of you have more significant memories, perhaps, of Lockridge and New Sweden than I certainly do, but I'm sitting next to Ann up here, and she wants to get things started, and I was the first to eat, so I get to be the first to talk, too. Many of you are aware of some of these connections, but it's always interesting to me what a family the larger church is and how we are connected in so many ways. I first heard about Lockridge 46 years ago. I was a young boy at the time. I really was. My parents were very active members of St. Mark's Lutheran Church in Cedar Rapids. And when that congregation was looking for a new pastor, and they hosted the pastor that they had selected to call, they came to our house. And being a pretty young boy at that time, I wanted to know where pastors came from. And I learned that they came from Lockridge. Because that was Pastor Angstrom. And he and his wife, little boys, who were littler than I was. Carl was 5 at the time, and I'm older than him. Came to our house in 1952. And so my parents and the members of St. Mark's and Cedar Rapids, from what I hear, there are still people in this congregation angry at them for calling their very good Pastor Angstrom. And I've met people today who shared with me that they were baptized by Pastor Angstrom or confirmed by Pastor Angstrom. I was confirmed by Pastor Angstrom. He was my ordination sponsor when I was ordained. He really, the parsonage when they moved to Cedar Rapids was 2 blocks away from the home I grew up in. And my folks being active in the church, and I had a younger brother, and the Angstroms had boys, and we spent an awful lot of time at each other's homes. And I learned from Pastor Angstrom that a person could be a human being, a really good human being, but a human being, and be a pastor. And I didn't have pastors in my family, but it's because of him, whom I refer to as my spiritual father, as some of you do, that I sensed the call to go into the ministry. When I was in 8th grade confirmation class, he had these individual meetings pastors have with their confirmands and said, "Have you ever thought about going into the ministry?" And that's when that really planted that seed. So it's amazing to me how the church is connected. When I went to college, I went off to Augustana College. And I know that places like Lockridge and New Sweden were small places, but there were people there like Barbara Smithberg, whose name is now LeMaster, who came from such places. And I became friends also with Bill and Ben Bogner, who were from such a place as Lockridge. And so for a big part of my life, I've known about this place. And so it's a special privilege for me to be here today, to participate in this service. And now I have actually seen where pastors come from. So thank you.
I saw Paul get up and I thought he was going right to the microphone, but he went to the dessert bar instead. My recollections of Lockridge was the fact that I came here as a young bride to I married Frank Weston, most of you know. And he recently died, but I have tremendous memories of him. And Mrs. Knutson helped revise some of those memories for me yesterday. When her husband was a new minister, just out of the seminary, they served here in this, I want to say parish, that's okay, isn't it? Okay, so they served here. Huh? That's Swedish? It's also something else. But anyhow, I remember that one evening, Russell called Frank and says, "Oh my gosh, you have to take the services on Sunday because my wife is going to the hospital and she's expecting a baby." So Frank came in very joyfully and he says, "Oh, guess what? We're going to have a baby and I'm going to take care of the church services." So he was always a willing, happy man. He wanted to participate. And we had four beautiful children. One of my daughters is sitting in here with us today. Maybe you know her, Claudia. She's married. She's married to a very wonderful man, John Gingginger, and I'm sure a lot of you know him too. Then we just took a big part in the church whole. That was our life, along with many of our friends who have demonstrated that this time because of our 150th anniversary, why everyone got busy and Kathleen Bugner said, "We've got to paint this church." So I think she donated some money and then we built a little church and boy, the money started piling up and pretty soon the young folk, even some of the older ones, got busy and they painted and decorated the church. And then the council decided we need to have the outside of the church painted. And so now we're ready for another 50 years. We replastered and did all sorts of things. And I don't like to single out anyone because everyone has been such a great help. But I do want to single out Cheryl Kroll because she's been the secretary and treasurer of this particular committee. And when my husband came ill, then she carried the ball. And I'm deeply indebted. I'm not certain that I can talk anymore, but Kathleen Bugner has a message from one of the pastors. And please, if you have anything to say, don't be shy. We all want to enjoy your stories, and even you newer members, we'd like to know what you think of us. We already know.
Some of you suspected I managed to talk, didn't you? Well, this is really the truth that that Dick Oatman's called me yesterday from Foley, Minnesota. I had talked to them on the telephone. I had talked to their answering machine, and they didn't get back to me, and so I knew they weren't coming. But yesterday he called, said they had been to their lake. They have a cottage on a lake. You know, Minnesota has a lake. They had been out there and had had a good time. And so we talked about him and his family. He has two children, which they had when they were here. And they have one granddaughter and three grandsons, and everyone is gainfully employed. And Pastor Oatman's retired a couple of years ago. And this church was really growing. It was growing so much that it was hard to just keep going with the growth. And I said, is your church still growing? And he said, yes, it is. You're still getting people from the Twin Cities? Yes, we are. He said, in fact, we have so many that they have just voted to do $1 million addition to the church. And he says, you know, I'm glad I don't have to oversee that. But they did retire in the home that they had built after he was a minister for some time, and they still live there. They are out of town quite a bit. And also, I wanted to tell you about his mother. She's 93 years old. She lives in her own home and drives her own car and just lives like she'd like to live. That's in Nebraska. They say Nebraska's a great place to live long. So I bring you those greetings, and he did mention several people that were active in church when he was here. And I think they have good memories of us.
Well, as many of you know, this was the church I grew up in. From the time I was a little girl, I can remember going to church, and all of our children were baptized and married in this church. But some of my recollections, I've got so many I won't bore you with most of them, but I remember certainly Pastor Engstrom as being teaching my confirmation class. It was a large class, and I think he did a very good job, because to the best of my knowledge, I think everyone in that class, and I think, well, you can look at the book, I think there was about, Betty, do you remember how many there were? 13? 14? To the best of my knowledge, I think every one of those persons is still a member of a Lutheran church, and I think that speaks to his good instruction way back in the beginning. I also remember his wife very well as being a wonderful pastor's wife, and at the time they were here, our new parsonage was built, and to show their appreciation after the parsonage was built, she invited each and every family in the congregation in for a very nice meal. She was a very good cook, and about, I think, six couples at a time. Was that about right, Myrtle? And the congregation was much larger than it was now. Do you remember how many people, couples would have been? I mean, we had a lot more people. She had to cook for a lot more people than you would if you were going to do that today. Another recollection I have of another pastor's wife is of Marjorie Knudsen. We happened to live in a small mobile home right across the street from the church when they were there, and our children were small. We were invited over to their home one Sunday for dinner. Now, you know, in this part of the country, dinner means noon. And Marjorie may not remember this, but I think they were from the city, and she probably meant in the evening. And so we went over right after church, and she hadn't put the roast in the oven yet. So we took our baby and went back home and put her down for a nap and went back when she was more prepared for us. I don't know, like I say, whether she remembers that or not, but I remember when one of our children was born. I think it was when Gary was born, came to visit and brought a loaf of bread and for us, and a little tiny loaf of bread for our daughter. So that was real sweet, just some of those special little things that you remember about pastors' wives who play a very important role.
This is a pastor that does the talking, but due to his problems with depression, Pastor Engstrom cannot put a sermon together anymore, and he doesn't, isn't able to talk. before large groups of people, but he can talk to people one-on-one. So, and he also has problems with his legs, and so he has to sit down quite a bit. So don't think he's trying to be off to the side. Please go up and talk to him and introduce yourself. He got to do most of the talking, and he got to use notes when he preached, too. So I have a few notes, and this will only take a half hour. In 1945, Dick Engstrom was sent to Lockridge as a student intern from Augustana College, Augustana Seminary, to spend the summer. And I'm not going to mention any names because I don't want to slight anybody. But anyhow, he spent the summer here preaching and doing the usual pastoral things. But his one main task was to get this class of 14 students confirmed. So they met twice a week at night. He had no discipline problems because they'd all been working in the fields during the day and they were tired. His main objective was to keep them awake. But anyhow, he did complete the instructions and Pastor Bonanno confirmed them before he left for the seminary in the fall. Then in 1946, he was given a call to serve First Augustana Lockridge in Clara Salina Lutheran Church. And he went to the man who was in charge of the calls and asked if there were any other possibilities. And they said, no, you don't want any other possibilities. They had targeted him to be here to help make the arrangements for the help make the arrangements for the 100th anniversary of the Augustana Lutheran Church, which was to be held at New Sweden, Iowa in 1948. And so for the first 2 years, he was busy making arrangements for that celebration, along with the help of every member of First Augustana. It was a big job. They had to straighten all the stones in the cemetery. They fixed up the grounds. They worked on the church building, restored it, and painted it, and got it all fixed up. They tuned up the organ and got that ready for the celebration. The women put out a cookbook, and we sold 1,000 copies and had to order 500 more. And this was for a souvenir for the people who came for the celebration. And then on the big day, a caravan came from Rock Island, Illinois, where the Synod Convention was being held. And about 3,000 people gathered in a big tent on the lawn at New Sweden for the big celebration. The dignitaries of the Augustana Lutheran Church, dignitaries from the Church of Sweden were there to help in the celebration, and it was a big day. The women served, we bought a whole cow, ground it all up in hamburgers, and the women served maid rites out of the kitchen window of the old parsonage, which was across the street from the church. And of course, there's a lot of homemade pies and cakes and so forth. So we did a lot of work, and it brought us all together as a congregation and as a people. The other big thing that I recall was the building of the parsonage. We lived in a house on the other side of the church, and then the new parsonage was built in 1950. And that too was a big undertaking for this congregation, and it's the only time I've ever heard of a building being built at cost less 10%. That the 10% was a donation from the Mennonite contractor who built the parsonage, and then he allowed anything that could be done by the people of the church, and he donated labor. He allowed them to do that. When he had something that needed to be done, he let them know, and they came and put up the drywall, and they did the painting and work on the foundation and so forth. So a lot of loving, donated hours of labor were put into that parsonage. And here again, the people worked together and very well. The confirmation class of 1945 was the nucleus of the Luther League,
while we were here. And they were one of the strongest groups in the district at that time. And they went to a lot of the district things and to Bible camps, and they were a really good group. And maybe that's why there's all still Lutherans, because they were really active in the Luther League. We formed a married couples group because there were a lot of young people who were just back from the service, a lot of young couples having their children. And we had this active young couples group, which we had a lot of fun with. Also, we had a strong women's group, and I guess in 1949, they kind of didn't know what to do with themselves after the big celebration at New Sweden, so they decided to have a smorgasbord. So we had our first smorgasbord in 1949, and that, too, created a lot of togetherness as we planned for it and worked through having this big dinner. And we didn't have any trouble selling tickets. We had a lot of good cooks. But what we remember most, oh, first of all, I want to say that I commend you for the way the church looks. It is just beautiful. We didn't have padded pews when we were here. And you have a beautiful new organ. And you have eternal light and those beautiful banners, and everything so looks so spick and span. And it shows that the pride you have in your church and your strong commitment to your church and to your Lord. The thing we remember most about Cedar Rapids is the people. We made many good friends here, and we were received with much love when we came to Lockridge, and you taught us a lot. We were from the big city, Chicago, and we moved to Lockridge, and it was quite a culture change. And we knew absolutely nothing about rural life, but you taught us. You taught us about farm life, and you taught us how to grow a garden. You taught Dick how to grow a garden, and you taught me how to can and take care of the produce after it was brought in, and not only what we grew, but what you gave us from your gardens and from your fruit trees and so forth. And also, you taught us how to kill and clean a chicken. And, and one of you taught me how to starch and iron a white shirt. I was brought up in a family with six women, and I knew nothing about white shirts. And my husband used at least six every week. And so one of the members taught me how to starch and iron a white shirt, a task which I hated always. You also taught us how to nurture our cistern and our water, which was something new to us because we had all the water we wanted in Chicago, but we soon learned how to live in a rural community. Also, you helped us with our children. There was always someone to take care of the children if we were going to a meeting or something like that. And you were very kind and gracious, and you accepted us as part of your family. You were our family while we were here in Lockridge. You opened your hearts and your homes to us, and we appreciated that very much. We shared the good times and some sad times together, but always you were loving and kind to us, and we appreciated that. We also appreciated the cooperation, or Dick did, of the church council and the congregation in working through problems and in trying new things, and you demonstrated to us your strong faith in your Lord and your strong commitment to the Church of God. And we thank you for all that you taught us while we were here. Most pastors' families say that their first parish is special, and that is certainly true of us. Our first parish was very special. And we thank you for all that you gave us, all that you taught us, and for the great love that you showed to us. And we certainly return that love to you. And we cherish the connections which we have maintained through the years. And we pray that God will bless you all as you continue to minister in this community.